Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Marjorie. Thank you. Yeah, I'm not doing it for everyone. We don't have time, I'm afraid, Sam. We're not starting that sort of shenanigans of going around everybody. But it's lovely to see you all. A warm welcome to our service today. Especially warm welcome if you are visiting the fellowship this afternoon as we meet together. And if you're one of our regulars, well, it's lovely to see you too. We're meeting together today to reflect on the death of our Lord Jesus, to remember what he has achieved for us. Isaiah, in writing years before Jesus came, pointed to what his death would achieve, to what the suffering servant would come and do for God's people. And Isaiah 53 reminds us of those things. Starting at verse 4, it says, "Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Today reminds us that Jesus died for us, that he suffered for us, for our sins, for our transgressions, for our iniquities. He suffered to bring us peace, to bring peace between us and the Lord, so that we can call him Father and know the peace that comes from being accepted by him. Let's take a moment, let's quieten our hearts before we come and sing and praise the one who died for us. I'll then pray and we'll stand and sing "How Deep the Father's Love for Us." Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for what today reminds us of, what today represents, that as we come and as we sing your praise, as we praise Jesus, we can do so knowing that we are accepted by you because of what he has done, because of his death, because of his suffering. We know that we are your children and we can come and praise you. Lord, be in our time together this afternoon, be in the things that we say, the things we sing, the things that are proclaimed, Lord, that it would cause us to know you more, to appreciate more what you went through for us, and above all, Lord, that we would leave here knowing more of you and seeking to walk more closely with you and loving you more, Heavenly Father. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, the we should give his grace to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain our searing heart, the Father's choosing strength.
few minutes, we're going to watch a video and have our Bible reading. I'm just going to share our notices now. I'm just letting you know that I'm doing that because obviously it's change and we don't always cope well with change and things being different. So just highlighting what we're doing. If you would like to know more about what we believe and what we understand as we think about it this afternoon, maybe as we talk about it, and maybe you're here this afternoon, I was going to say this morning, but this afternoon, because you're thinking about what it means to be a Christian. We will be running a short course, it's only 3 weeks, towards the end of April and May, called Hope Explored. Just thinking about what it means to trust and believe and to follow Jesus. So if that's something you'd be interested in and would like to know more, please speak to Sue or Janet. We will make sure you know who they are after the service. If you're unsure, please, you can come and speak to me or Anthony, who will be stood up in a little bit, and we will point you towards them or share some more information. But if you'd like to know more and think about what it means to be a Christian, please do ask, and we'd happily talk to you about that. After today's service, we are going to be having some fish and chips together. So please do stick around. You might just be here visiting, in which case, please do come through. There will be some spare fish and chips. And some people, I'm not saying me, but some people will be happy probably to share what fish and chips they've got so no one goes hungry. We will go through to the other side of the building and we'll eat through there and we'll explain everything that's going on at the end of the service. But please don't rush away. Please do share. We'd rather share what we have and make it stretch than people go home and not stay and share fellowship. Other things that are happening over this Easter weekend, there's a praise night, Easter praise tomorrow night. If you haven't heard about it, what have you been doing for the last few weeks? It's all over my Facebook page. It's going to be a great opportunity to join together with other local churches in the area and continue reflecting on the meaning of Easter with songs and prayers and readings, just to focus our mind on what is happening this weekend. So please do come. That's 7 o'clock tomorrow night at St. Thomas's Church. We'll be back here on Sunday morning, 9:45, as we remember and celebrate the fact that Jesus is risen from the dead, that the tomb is empty, and because of that, we have the hope of new life in him. That's 9:45 as we remember and celebrate Easter Sunday morning here. Do come and join us. And if that's not enough, on Monday, if you've still got any energy and stamina left after what is a marathon weekend of social events, we will be joining together in Ashton Flower Park at 11 a.m. for a bring your own picnic. Bring any chairs or blankets or ball games or friends that you will want to use and play with during the whole weekend, but we would really love to see you. Please do come and join together. We will be in the Flower Park from 11. You don't have to be there at 11. We won't turn you away if you turn up at 11:30, but please do come and share fellowship with us then. In just a few moments, I'm going to ask Ben to come and share our reading, which is from the book of Acts this afternoon. I knew I'd do it at least once or twice for us this afternoon. And then Anthony's going to come and share some thoughts for us on that passage. But before that, we're just going to watch a video by the Bible Project that's looking at the last section of Luke's Gospel, taking us from chapter 19 through to 23, focusing our minds on what we are thinking about today and reflecting and drawing our minds together as we come together. So we'll just watch this short video and then Ben will come up for us.
So we're walking through the Gospel of Luke and we've reached the end of Jesus' long road trip to Jerusalem. He's arrived.
So he rides a donkey down the Mount of Olives towards the city, and all these crowds are forming, and people are singing, "Praise the King who comes in the name of the Lord." They're laying down their cloaks in front of him.
Now, why all this royal treatment?
Okay, so Israel's ancient prophets promised that one day God himself would arrive and rescue his people and rule the world. Other times, the prophet spoke about a coming king who would ride into Jerusalem to bring justice and peace.
So Jesus is activating all these hopes that he's that king, and everyone's ecstatic.
Well, not everybody. The religious leaders, they think Jesus is a threat to their power, and so they're not happy. But even more striking, Jesus himself is distraught. He's actually weeping as he rides.
Yeah, why?
Well, Jesus can see what is coming. He knows that he won't be accepted as Israel's king, and he knows that Israel will keep going down a destructive path, neglecting the poor, stirring up rebellion against their Roman oppressors, and he knows that it will lead to death It breaks his heart.
And it riles him up. The first thing he does in Jerusalem is march into the temple courts, and he drives out the money changers, disrupting the entire sacrificial system.
Yeah, he's staging a prophetic protest, and he stands in the center of the courtyard, shouting out words from Israel's ancient prophets. This is supposed to be a place of worship, but you've made it a den of rebels.
A den of rebels?
Yeah, he's quoting from the prophet Jeremiah, who stood in this same spot, the center of Israel's religious and political power. And he offered the same critique of Israel's leaders, that they're rebellious and corrupt.
And they get the message and start to plan to have him killed.
Which is no surprise to Jesus. In fact, he planned that all of this would happen during Passover.
This is the Holy Week when Jewish people celebrate their ancient story of how God liberated them from slavery and invited them into a covenant relationship.
And so Jesus uses the symbols of Passover to reveal the meaning of his coming death. The broken bread was his broken body, and the wine was his blood that would establish a new covenant relationship between God and Israel. Jesus was going to die for his people and open up a new way forward.
After the meal, Jesus takes his disciples to a garden to pray.
And he struggles with the very human desire to save his life instead of sacrificing it, but he overcomes this temptation.
And it's here where the religious leaders with the temple guards find him and arrest him.
Now, Jerusalem was being ruled by the Roman Empire, and so the temple leaders couldn't execute Jesus without permission from their Roman governor, a man named Pontius Pilate. And so they make up this charge that Jesus is a rebel king stirring up revolution against the Roman emperor.
Pilate asks Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?"
And Jesus answers, "You say so."
So Pilate can see that Jesus is an innocent man and he doesn't deserve death.
But the leaders keep insisting that he is dangerous. So they negotiate a compromise. Pilate will release an actual rebel against Rome, a man named Barabbas, instead of Jesus. And so the innocent is handed over in the place of the guilty.
Jesus is taken away with two other accused criminals and nailed to a Roman execution device. And people are mocking him. "Hey, if you're the Messianic king, save yourself and us."
But Jesus loved his enemies to the very end, offering hope to one of the criminals dying beside him. And he even prayed for his executors, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing."
And then the sky darkened as an innocent man died the death of a rebel.
And then Jesus cried out with ancient words from Israel's Psalms, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And then Jesus died, innocent and alone.
The reading this morning is taken from, is taken from Acts chapter 2, verses 22 to 39. "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to a cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, 'I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with your joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand, until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. Amen.
Well, hello and good afternoon. Thank you to Ben for reading, to James and others for leading our time today. My name is Anthony, if you don't know. It is lovely to see so many people out on Friday afternoon. Special welcome, as James has already said, to any family or friends who are visiting today. Throughout history, there are many stories of people who've given their lives on behalf of others, and stories of sacrifice touch us deeply. And yet the days we remember at Easter are known and remembered all over the world, as we recall the greatest sacrifice in history, when Jesus suffered and died, was buried, and then rose again from the dead. Christians believe that Jesus' death and resurrection made it possible for men and women to come into a relationship with God that lasts forever, even beyond the grave. And you know, no other death has captured the imagination of artists, of musicians, of writers and scholars as much as the death of Jesus. It is at the very heart of the Christian message. But you might be surprised to hear that the earliest known visual depiction of the crucifixion actually makes fun of it. It's a piece of ancient graffiti, and you can see it there on the screen. It's scratched into the plaster of what was an old schoolhouse just on the outskirts of Rome. And it depicts a figure. You can see it in the outline drawing there. It depicts a figure with the head of a donkey hanging on the cross. And underneath there stands a man, and his hand is raised in reverence. And below is a caption which reads, Alexamenos worships his God. Now, to be clear, the ridicule is not that Jesus died. The Roman world knew of God's dying. The ridicule is that he was executed as a criminal in the most shameful way possible. And in Roman culture, that was something to mock. Now, the comedy of the graffiti might not carry well across the centuries, but the message is clear. The man on the cross isn't a god, he's an ass. And anyone who worships such a God is also a fool and to be pitied. And you know, there's always the danger, isn't it, that the cross sounds tame to us 2,000 years on, when crosses tend to be shiny metal objects that we wear as jewelry or ornamental symbols in church. And it's easy to forget that the cross represents an ancient, actually not just ancient, but a method of execution. But more than that, in a status-hungry Roman world, crucifixion was the most degrading, the most disgraceful, dishonorable death imaginable. It was known as the slave's punishment. It was shameful, as well as painful. And yet, Christians around the world and through the ages have constantly confessed the centrality of the cross. Because our faith makes no sense without it. Why? Well, because the Bible tells us that the cross is God's unique way of dealing with our sin and its consequences, guilt, shame, fear, and death. And that's why, paradoxically, today is Good Friday. And that's also why so many of us meet today, to remind ourselves that the cross, with its power to save, lies at the heart of our Christian faith and our Christian life. In our church recently, we've worked our way through the book of Acts. This is the second longest book in the New Testament. It was written by Luke, who was a historian and a doctor, and it tells the story of the spread of Christianity across the Roman Empire in the first few decades after the death and resurrection of Jesus. And as we heard from Ben's reading in Acts chapter 2, right from the word go, Luke shows how the death of Jesus was understood by people in the early church, and then how it was told to others, and how it then shaped the lives of the believers. We're going to come back to that passage on Easter Sunday and look at it in a little bit more detail. But I wanted over this Easter weekend to bring us back to the book of Acts just for two more bites, okay, out of the book of Acts. And then I promise you, we really will leave it behind for a while. On Sunday, we'll look at Jesus' resurrection in Acts, where we'll see Jesus as the living Lord. But today, we're going to look at Jesus' death in Acts, where we see Jesus as the suffering servant. And I want us to explore, just briefly this afternoon, three points about the cross as it's spoken of in the book of Acts, but three points that I hope we'll find interesting and helpful as we reflect on the cross this Good Friday. And the first is that the cross marks the completion of a plan. What we see in Luke's gospel and in the book of Acts is that the death of Jesus isn't some tragic accident. It comes about as a result of people's evil planning, but it doesn't catch God unawares. As we heard in our reading, it comes about by God's design and plan and foreknowledge. In fact, Jesus' death is the fulfillment of promises that God had made many centuries before. Peter ends up speaking about some of those in that speech that Ben read to us. But this is how Peter puts it in another one of his speeches in Acts. But this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Heaven must receive him until the time comes for God to restore everything, as he promised long ago through his holy prophets. And then later on in that same speech, Peter says, indeed, beginning with Samuel, all the prophets who have spoken have foretold these days. Later on, in a different context, Paul says much the same thing. I am saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer, and as the first to rise from the dead, would bring the message of light to his own people and to the Gentiles. The completion of a plan. And so with those, for those with eyes to see, this has been clearly signposted in the past. Let's just take a few examples, some stories that you might remember. The Bible tells a story about Abraham, the father of the Jewish people, and to test his faith, God asks Abraham to make a sacrifice of Isaac, the son he loves, the son of promise. And amazingly, Abraham is prepared to go through with it. The Bible tells us that he's confident that God will somehow provide a sacrifice when the time comes. And sure enough, at just the last moment, God steps in and stops him. And Abraham sees a ram caught in a thicket. And we read in the Bible that he took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. The animal becomes a substitute for Isaac. Abraham ends up calling that place, "The Lord will provide." Indeed, the Lord does. Because, you know, later on in Israel's history, a whole system of animal sacrifices is set up. And that's a powerful, visceral, graphic reminder to the people of the basis on which they can live with God and he can live with them. And on a special day, as you might know, once a year, an animal would be brought to the high priest who would lay his hand on it, confessing the sin of the people. I don't think he itemized everything. I think he generalized a little bit, but symbolically transferring the guilt of the people to the animal, which would then die in their place. Again, a reminder that sin always brings death. Either the death of the substitute or the death of the sinner. Then later on, as James reminded us, no colluding beforehand, the prophet Isaiah. God makes a series of promises of a coming servant who would represent the people, who would be led like a lamb to the slaughter and be killed on behalf of others, and yet would somehow triumph through his death. Those are just a few examples. Even before the coming of Jesus into history, God was pointing forward in different ways to a coming Savior. And in the death of Jesus, that plan has been brought to its completion. I think that's a great comfort to us who are Christians. It tells us that Jesus' death isn't plan B or plan C when plan A failed. It's always been God's plan A. It was always God's plan to show his love for the world in sending Jesus, who would willingly die to rescue men and women. And that plan, Luke tells us, both in his gospel and in the book of Acts, has been brought to its completion. But let's dig a little bit more into how it comes about as we think secondly about the provision of a sacrifice. You know, in keeping with all those promises in the Bible, Luke is clear that the death of Jesus is the only way that men and women can be forgiven. As we saw in that video, Luke tells us through the words of Jesus himself at the Last Supper that the death he was to die, he would do so on behalf of others. So he took the bread, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you." And he took the wine, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Now, this meal was, of course, bound up with the Jewish festival of Passover. Passover reminded the people of God's deliverance of them out of Egypt centuries earlier when God freed his people from slavery. And if you know the story, you'll know that the means of salvation for Israel was a slaughtered lamb, with the angel of the Lord killing all the firstborn in Egypt, but passing over the houses which were marked with the blood of the lamb. And so God's people were able to look at the lamb on their tables and the blood on their door frame, and know that a lamb had substituted for them. And now here is Jesus, who would deliver his people by taking that judgment on himself. In his own death as the Lamb of God, that he would release his people from slavery. His death would clear the way for people to be rightly related to God. Of course, that's what we see being played out in the book of Acts. Let's look again at what Peter says in chapter 3. But this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God. Why? So that your sins may be wiped out. The times of refreshing may come from the Lord. And he says something similar a few chapters later. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. And later on too, when he's speaking now not to Jewish people, but to a Roman centurion, he says, all the prophets testify, remember? All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Again, Paul says the same, having spoken to people about God bringing his plan to completion in the death and resurrection of Jesus, Paul goes on and he says, therefore, my friends, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Through him, everyone who believes is set free from every sin, a justification you were not able to obtain under the law of Moses. Well, those are just some examples in the book of Acts. We could look at many. And then, of course, you might be interested to know that Jesus is sometimes referred to in the book of Acts as God's servant. Where have we heard that language before? Well, as we said a few moments ago, the servant was the promised figure in Isaiah, a man of sorrows who bears the sins of the people in their place. Some of us might remember the story that Luke tells in Acts of one of the early Christians called Philip, who's dispatched to a desert road, and while he's there, he hears an Ethiopian official in his chariot, who just happens to be at that moment, reading from a scroll the very part of Isaiah which contains the words that James read to us at the start of the service. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. And then the Ethiopian asks Philip, tell me please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Well, what a brilliant question to ask an evangelist. You know, it's like the spiritual equivalent of an open goal, isn't it? Don't mess it up, Philip. But he doesn't, because Luke tells us that Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. Philip took that passage and talked about Jesus, about how he was like that spotless sacrificial lamb who suffered on behalf of others. He told the Ethiopian how Jesus did take that punishment in our place so that we could be declared not guilty and set free. Philip told him about Jesus dying for men and women and boys and girls like you and me. He told them about a servant who would not only rescue Israel, but whose light would then extend to all people of all nations, including Ethiopians. Which, of course, was great news to an Ethiopian. And great news to us too. I say us deliberately, as that brings us to our final point about the death of Jesus in the book of Acts. And it's about the formation of a people. Jesus' death is applied to us personally and individually. Let's make no mistake about that. But as we see in the book of Acts, his death also brings us together into a body of people that we call the church. In Acts chapter 20, you might remember Paul is saying an emotional farewell to the elders of the church in Ephesus. And at one point, he says this, keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. Now notice that the church is God's church, and it became so through blood, or with the blood of his son. And the picture, in a sense, is like what Abraham had been willing to do with Isaac, only here God carries out that offering so that others can benefit from his sacrifice. The Lord really does provide. And as we see in the book of Acts, the death of Jesus opens a door for others, Jews and Gentiles, men and women, slave and free, rich and poor, people of different skin colours, people of different ethnicities, people like us. And what centres us in this new community, what unites us together, is our relationship with Jesus, which comes about only through his death. And as we also see in the book of Acts, it's the death of Jesus that provides a pattern of life for the Christian, in which we give of ourselves for others, just as he did. It's the death of Jesus which makes sense of our suffering as Christians. Because if Jesus is a suffering servant, his disciples are the servants of the servant. We see, don't we, in the book of Acts that they suffer in Jerusalem just as Jesus did. Paul travels to Jerusalem to suffer just as Jesus did. So something of his death marks our lives as his followers. And it's that death which his followers remember as they break bread together, as we see them doing in the book of Acts, reenacting that special meal which focuses on the body and the blood of Jesus. In all sorts of ways, the death of Jesus establishes us together as God's new covenant people. Why do we gather together today? Why do we mark this day, this Good Friday? Because the death of Jesus brings about the completion of a plan, the provision of a sacrifice, and the formation of a people. The death of Jesus wasn't a tragic outcome of his mission, it was his central goal, it was why he came. The Bible tells us that our relationship with God is severed and it needs restoring. We don't need a self-improvement plan. We don't need a wellness expert. I don't even know what one of those is, but I've heard about them. We need a savior. We need a savior. One who freely took our sin on himself. As it's been said, I owed a debt I could not pay. He paid the debt he did not owe. Back to the donkey on a cross. It might look foolish, but it's where ultimate hope lies. It might look foolish, but it's where real freedom is available. It might look foolish, but it's where true life is found. And may we today and this Easter weekend celebrate the truth of the cross, Christ crucified and risen. Amen. Let's pray before we sing some songs in response. The musicians can come to the front. Pray along with me, if you like, as a way of saying that you also want to give thanks for Jesus' death on your behalf and be committed to him. But let's pray together now. Lord God, on this day of all days, we thank you that you're a God who loves us and who's reached out to us in Jesus and supremely in his death on the cross. We thank you for this opportunity to see again what it means that Jesus died for us. And we ask that you'll impress it upon our hearts and that it will not only save us, but give us comfort and confidence at these times in which we live. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand together.
When I survey the wondrous that should discover me. Oh. Thank you.
we're going to come together to break bread, to affirm what we've just been singing about, that what Jesus' death achieves and accomplishes for us. It's that reminder for us that Good Friday is not the end. We break bread and we continue to remember his death on the cross. Taking part in this is an act for believers, those who have put their trust in Jesus as Lord and Saviour. Doing it doesn't make you right with God. It's not a rite of passage that we need to go through to continually ensure that we somehow have a relationship with him. Instead, it is a picture of what he has done for us. A reminder for those who have trusted him that he died for me, that his body was broken for me, that his blood was spilled for my sin. Reminding ourselves of how he suffered to bring us into new life, but proclaiming that he will come again. If you're unsure, if you don't know really if you should be taking part, please don't worry, please don't feel embarrassed. Please feel free to let the elements of bread and juice pass before you. But please feel free to ask about what it means and why we do this and how you too can have relationship with the Lord Jesus. Going back into Isaiah, it again reminds us what Jesus has done for us. Picking up from verses 10 to 12, it says, "Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. And by his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressors." It's only through Jesus' death that we are made right with God. That is what we remember. That is what we proclaim. That is what we are giving thanks about. It's something to be somber about, something to reflect about with a heavy heart. But it was also a bittersweet moment that it is something to rejoice in. Because we are going to continue to remember his death. I wonder if when we picture heaven, we just think of Jesus as the risen one. He will still have the scars, and so often in Revelation is pictured as the lamb who was slain. We will continue to sing his praise as the one who died for us. We won't get to heaven and all of a sudden have moved on and just sing about future things. We will proclaim his death and continue to celebrate what he has done. I'm going to pray in a moment, and after I've done so, myself and Anthony will pass round the bread. And then a few moments later, Jenny and Jason will pass round the wine, which is just juice here at the Beacon. Please do eat them as you receive them, as a reminder for you that Jesus died for you. Before I pray, I'm going to just read some words from a song that's kind of been stuck in my head from Word Alive for the last few days, that just reminds us of what Jesus has done for us. So let's pray. Who else would die for our redemption? Whose resurrection means our rise? There isn't time enough to sing of all you've done, but I have eternity to try. With 1,000 hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. 1,000 hallelujahs and 1,000 more. Heavenly Father, we thank you that because of Jesus, we know that we will have eternity with you. That we can't tell of all you've done for us, Lord, but we know that we will be with you for that time. We thank you, Lord, for all that Jesus' death accomplishes and achieves. We thank you for whatever we've done. Maybe that weight and knowledge of sin that bears heavy on us at times, that feels difficult, that feels hard, that we remember even when we try and forget. Those things that maybe we don't even want to forgive ourselves for. We thank you that the Lord Jesus' death covers them, that his death deals with them, that they have been paid for, that because of him we have new life and the opportunity to sing your praises forever. Lord, we give you thanks this afternoon. We thank and praise you for Jesus, for his death, and for the hope that we know we have because of his resurrection. Thank you for his suffering in our place. Lord, help us to understand these things more and to live in response to them, we pray, Heavenly Father. Amen.
Let's stand together.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Paul writes to the Romans and says, "What shall we say in response to all these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will not he also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord."